Can we give the Lord a hand this morning? Isn't he awesome? Isn't he good? Church, over the last while, we have been on a journey. Our vision, as we continually, or as we articulate it now, is based in Isaiah 58. If you haven't yet encountered that passage of Scripture, if you haven't yet read it, I challenge you and encourage you to go do that this afternoon. But in Isaiah 58, God comes to his people and he says, I want you to understand what this whole worship thing, what this whole fasting, what this whole being in relationship with God is all about. And the gist of it, he kind of says, look, I see you coming every Sabbath and bowing down. I see you bringing your offerings and your prayers. But if that doesn't impact the way you treat other people, if that doesn't make a difference in the way you connect with humanity around you, then what's the point? He says, this is the fast I require, that you break the chains of injustice, that you untie the cords that are keeping people bound, that you set the oppressed free, that you feed the hungry, clothe the naked. And he carries on to go and say that when people around us see this, when people encounter that, the kingdom of God is born. The kingdom of God is experienced. The kingdom of God comes alive in their reality. And so, yep, gathering is awesome. Praying and singing is awesome. That's all part of being the body of Christ. But if it doesn't impact how we go and treat other people each and every day, then what is the point? That whole Isaiah 58 is then put in the context of Sabbath. That this is what it means to live out Sabbath. This is what it means to bring Sabbath into the lives of people. Sabbath is rest or peace. It comes from the Hebrew word Shabbat, and it was closely connected to Shalom, which is peace. How do we bring peace and rest into people's lives? It's when we set them free. It's when we connect them into community. It's when we bring love and light into their life. And so the whole Isaiah 58, and this is our vision, to be a church community that makes that connection, that our relationship with God directly impacts the communities and the people around us. Otherwise, what's the point? Jesus, when he came and articulated his mission, he quoted these very things from Isaiah. He used Isaiah 61. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to set the oppressed free, to loose the chains of injustice, to untie the cords of yoke. And he declared, and the day of God's favor, the time of God's favor has come. God's kingdom is here. It's among us. And then he called his people. He said, now you go. Now you go and be the agents of freedom. You go and be the agents of peace. You go and be the agents of reconciliation. I am sending you. When he sent his disciples, the book of Acts tells a little story where they gathered just before Jesus says his farewell to them. And he gives them this charge. He says, go. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you and you go out, start in Jerusalem. Papsda, start here in Auckland. We're going to live out Isaiah 58. Let's start here in Auckland. Then he says, go to Samaria. And that's beyond the Bombays. That's the South Island. Okay, go to Samaria. And then he says, and go into the rest of the world. Our living out, our engaging with God, our experience of the kingdom of God should not be limited to where we are and our context. And so that is what we want to share with you. And I'm going to invite Leanne to come up. Leanne leads our international service team. And Leanne, just share with us what that looks like, what that has looked like for us here at Papsda.
Sure. Well, as many of you will know, I've had the opportunity to lead now 5 teams of Papsda volunteers to Cambodia. And every time I go to Cambodia, I am reminded yet again what an incredible bubble we here in New Zealand live in compared to most of the rest of the world. But the reality of it is that while we do live in somewhat of a bubble, we are a part of the rest of the world. And those borders, those boundaries that have been created around each country are entirely artificial. We call ourselves New Zealanders or Kiwis or South Africans or Samoans or Brazilians or Australians, but the reality of it is we're all humans and we are all children of God. And like Norman said, we are all called to serve and to bless other people, and God has equipped and empowered us to do that. So if you've been here at Papsda for a little while, you will know that we have got partnerships with organisations in Cambodia, in South Africa, and today we're going to talk about a new partner organisation that we're going to work with, and they're called Captivating International. We've been very intentional here about at Papsda about picking the partners that we work with. We want to work with people not that just give a hand out, but people that give a hand up. We want to work with partners that are empowering and equipping people to with skills that will enable them to lift themselves and their family and their community out of poverty and to make a difference for the way they live their lives. And secondly, we've chose organisations that we can partner with that are well established, that have high integrity levels, and that have a relational link to here at us at Papsda. Like with Cambodia, we're working with ADRA, and we have strong ADRA connections through our church. With South Africa, we're working with Komalela and with Liz and Norm's family in South Africa. And now we're going to talk a little bit more about Captivating today. Here at Papsda, we really value freedom. We talk about it a lot. But the reality of it is there are 45,000 slaves at least in this world today. 45 million slaves in this world today. 45 million people who do not get any choice in how they live their life. Andrew and Julie Colquhoun are people who are making a difference in this area. We get to partner with them. Right now, we're going to have a look at the screen and have our first introduction to Captivating International, and then we're going to chat to Andrew and Julie. So have a look at the screen.
Hate that fear. I've seen you here before. You keep coming back and knocking at my door. For so long, so long, I've been trying to solve with my hands tied up and my feet held to the floor. But I'm feeling like a breakthrough is coming.
Wow, that was powerful. Welcome, Andrew and Julie. Thank you for joining us here.
Thank you.
The way we've articulated our mission in light of Isaiah 58 is that we seek to restore and reconcile people to God and each other by hearing their story and sharing God's story. And so today we really want to hear your story, but also through you, we're going to hear the story of a whole lot of people that you've been working with. And so we're excited about that. So we'll start with you, Andrew. I believe you were born in New Zealand.
Yes, it's been a long time since I've come here. I've been trying to practice my accent for the last few years, but I'm a Napier boy. So there's a few people here, in fact, that are like family to me. So Carl and Karen, or Carl or Karen, I should say, are you? Whereabouts are you, Karen? Karen, I grew up with Karen in New Zealand. Her sister Angela was the first girl I ever kissed. So I don't know whether I've gone too far already in terms of that. And I just met Leah, your daughter, at the back, and I realised I'm now old. So it's incredible. It's so great. Hayley Duncan, or Davidson now, who I used to babysit. Don, you know, she's just the same. Still a bit stinky, you know. It's just awesome. It feels like coming home. And I was here in November last year, which is when I met you and came home for a funeral. And I didn't realise it was 20 years. And I know where the tissues are here at the front. Well, since doing this sort of work, I live about 2 degrees above the tear line, apparently, most of the time. But it's great being home. Lovely.
It's great to have you back,
Andrew. Yeah.
Julie, where are you from? I know you're not a Kiwi.
No, but I love Kiwis. I'm originally, I was born on Western Australia on a farm, and I grew up looking after sheep and riding motorbikes. And yeah.
And how did you meet this handsome
How
Kiwi?
Did I meet? I met Andrew at Avondale. And of course, everybody says, I'm not sure whether they do the same thing at Longburn, but they tell you, well, oh, you're going to do the matrimonial course. I went, no. But anyway, that's what happened. So yes.
Me too.
Yeah. And we met, obviously we're at Avondale, we're doing business together. And Stephen was actually a year ahead of us doing business as well. So we go back a long way. And you were there for like a short time, I think, as well, doing nursing. So yeah, that's the connection, and we've known you guys for a long time. So
when I first met Julie, we studied for a year together before we sort of had an interest in going further. And I can always remember looking at Julie, knowing that she was the one. But what's the point? Because when I graduate, I'm back to New Zealand, so you might as well not get started. And we went down to the swing bridge there at Mighty Avondale College, and Julie was talking about, should we start going out? And I said, look, I don't think we should do it because you're the girl I'm going to marry and we'll be back to New Zealand. You're not going to come. And she's looking at me thinking, do you think you're overthinking this at the moment? But anyway, I got together and we've been together since. So.
Yeah. And you never came back to New Zealand. Well, not for more than a little bit. Andrew, you've got lots of ongoing Papsda connections that you have had over those last few years, though. Tell us a little bit about that. Mm.
Well, I think for us, there's yourself and Steve. You know, you guys have been with us for a long time now, supporting our work, and it's been just wonderful. Mm. You want to carry on? Okay, now carry on, because I'm going to talk about my pigs. I like pigs. You saw a few pig photos in that. Ronnie likes pigs as well. Ronnie's over there. He's got a pig herd up the top of China that he and I built together many years ago. And so it's been a wonderful thing, Ronnie. They're still going, I think. I'm not too sure, but the reproductive cycles of pigs are amazing. It was one of the very first projects, in fact, that we started doing in China. I've jumped ahead a little bit, but to try and talk to Adventist church communities about raising pig herds as a way of sustaining the livelihoods of people was a hard sell, but it was certainly easier than dog businesses. So thank you, Ronnie. It's been awesome.
Cool. And then I believe you also knew the Buse family and Brent.
Yeah, so John and Anne Buse. Anne Buse is, I'm a Colquhoun, so I'm related to the whole Buse side. And so Amanda and Brendan Pratt, going back a few years here, so related there, and Stephen Buse, and of course my sister Lindy Fraser, who was at this church as well.
Awesome.
So it feels like, although I think I've been here once before in my life, it feels coming home, really.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Mm.
Well, glad to have you guys. So tell us a bit about Captivating. How did that begin?
I'll start this because Julie's going to take over when it gets to the Nepal section, but I think Captivating is one of those stories that just sort of happens. I think if you talk to most people that get involved in any business or charity or whatever it is, it starts with humble beginnings and then goes places that maybe you didn't expect. So, you know, I remember growing up as a kid in Napier, I was a fairly shy sort of fella, still am largely. And then going through to Avondale, it was all about business and career and focused on, you know, making as much money as possible and living a comfortable life. And all those things are really important. I still value a lot of that. But the reality is for myself, especially got to the age of 40, something happens when guys turn 40 and you look at the page of things that you've achieved in your life. And, you know, there's lots of ticks on it and things are very stable. And yet there's this hole, this gap that exists. And so, I realized that it was time for a change at that point. And Julie had been pushing away for years about trying to do something for the world. And so we sat down and during this time I was flying probably three months a year all over the world, and part of a job I used to be involved in the McDonald's side of the business. And I remember flying at 30,000 feet and it just hit me saying, oh, this is just waste. What am I doing? And it's all about stuff that's all about me. And so that's when Julie started talking a little bit more, and we met in Chicago, which is where Tyler was as a three-year-old boy at the time. And we just sat down and said, well, what are we going to do? And the focus was, well, we're both passionate about children. We were devastated when we'd see children of the world suffering. And what are we going to do about it? So I resigned and Captivating started within a year. And the picture you see up on the screen now, that was us when we pretty much got off the boat in China. And we worked in an orphanage there and little orphan kids. And
why China? How did it start in China? What's the connection there?
I think, normally you don't think about going to China, or way back then. That's not wasn't on my radar. I'm not sure whether it's on a lot of people's radar like 10 years ago. But for us, Andrew was working with a company, and we had decided that we were going to resign, or he was going to resign, and he went there to spoke to the CEO, and she said, look, don't resign, why don't you come to China and we can do it together. So Andrew was in human resource management for the company, and they wanted to set up a charity over there, and so it was like, yep. Yeah. And that was it. That was pretty much it. Like, we obviously, you know, it had taken time to get to that point. And I remember speaking to a very, an older, wiser lady and saying, I really want to do something. It was just on my heart to go and help people, those that are, unfortunate, the orphan. And she said to me, you know, you can't do anything yet until your husband is ready. You have to do it together. So sometimes we have these desires and dreams to go, oh, let's do it. But, you know, we have to bring our spouses along as well and wait. And so that's how we got to China. Yeah.
So when we're in China, the charity that we formed for this company, about a year later, we realised that's not what we're passionate about. And this picture you see up there, this is about 2 hours south of the Russian border in China. This is in summer. It's an incredibly cold place, 9 months of the year, iced over. And we came face to face with children who were orphaned or abandoned. And there, where there was no welfare institution at the time, they would live on the streets. And so if you can imagine, you know, as a child trying to survive what would sometimes be minus 40 degrees temperatures, these guys would literally wrap themselves around underground heating pipes to get through the winters. And you know, we went up there to work with a Chinese Christian church group, a three self-registered church, who had a real heart for doing something for what they estimated to be about 500 to 1,000 orphans in their city, but they had no means to do it. So we went up there and established a foster family village program, our very first time of doing this. We were clueless, and some of the mistakes we made was terrible, but, you know, we went up there thinking we've got to do something. And I still remember vividly, I don't know whether you know the song of Stephen Curtis Chapman, I saw the face of Jesus in a little orphan girl. You know, and that story came out as I was looking in this girl. I'm sitting there thinking this song, thinking, oh, this is terrible. Looking in the eyes of this girl, realizing, you know what, make your choice. Are you in or you're out?
And that was a real turning point for you then.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What's this 1 minute summary of what Captivating is all about?
1 minute summary from me, oh my gosh.
Or the 30 second summary or whatever you...
So 1 minute, I guess for us, we've been doing Captivating now for 10 years. So the 1 minute summary is that we exist in the world to find largely girls, you know, there's boys that are orphaned as well, but we're in trouble, but we're largely finding girls that are what we call point A, which is positions of absolute desperation and zero hope. So in other words, if there is not help given to these girls, then they face incredibly challenging lives, potentially also death, right? So this is point A. Our role as an organisation is to take them from point A to point B, and point B means different things to different people, so that's why we can have no cookie cutter model, but it's all about point B being hope, genuine choice. And this is what these kids need when they grow up, is what do they choose to do? At the moment they have no choice, so how do we transition them from point A to point B? And you know, for us today, that moment of transition, if we average that out, that is happening every 2 hours somewhere in the world.
Wow. Mm. That's awesome.
It's incredible, hey?
So I think it's giving, we're talking about freedom today, you know, freedom from oppression, freedom from being destitute and hopelessness. We're giving that a choice, you know, giving them a chance at life that, yeah. That as Andrew said about that young lady, if it's not me or not you, then who does it? Mm. Who looks them in the eye and say... Yeah. I'm sorry.
I'm going to stand up for
I'm
you.
I'm sorry. I'm going to stand up for you. I'm going to speak up. And God talks about that in Proverbs, which is one of my favourite chapters, where it talks about speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for those that are destitute. And so, yeah, it's that whole freedom concept.
Yeah. We have this statement that our team and our partners, and we, like you, we do a lot of stuff through partners, right? And it's a statement of when they're face-to-face with a girl that meets the criteria of point A, the statement is your problem stops with me. And so it's not Band-Aids. We, you know, aid is wonderful and there are times when aid is necessary, but you know what? It's about how do we solve your problem permanently that gives you the chance to decide what your next move is. That's the transition that we're looking at.
And what I love about what you've been sharing is that you had no clue when you started. You don't have to have it all figured out.
Yeah.
But it's just making that decision, making that choice. I'm going to be the one that makes a difference for this person.
Yeah. We have a lot of people coming up to us very nice and saying, oh, you guys are wonderful. You know, no, we're not. We're just normal people. The most difficult part of what we did was taking that first step. And I think so many times we all grow up wanting to make sure we don't waste time and all that sort of thing. But so many times we overthink, like I overthought meeting Julie, we overthink the fact of that first step. We don't need to have it all together. It's in the same way that when we come to Jesus, he doesn't expect us to come as perfect people. He wants us to come as broken people that just have a heart for him. Well, this is what charity's about. This is any concept that working around you here in Papatoa, it's all about being willing to take that first step of faith, and then God does the rest miraculously. So in fact, be careful when you pray, break me for the heart, the things of break yours. It's going to be damaging to you and you'll give up a lot, but at the end Jesus says, you know, I've got you where I want you, now let's do my plan, it's not yours. Yeah.
Because this has taken you beyond just China, you're working in other parts of the world. Tell us a bit about that.
Well, we also work in Kenya, and we're working with orphans, and we're working with sometimes single mothers and families that are destitute. They're on the poverty line. And we want to try and connect, as Andrew said, that point A and point B. So we've got the children who are orphaned, and a lot of them have lost, you know, their parents from AIDS over there. And we've got families that want to help others but physically can't and just don't have the means. And so we have a program where put the two together, but we're also giving like microfinance, so loans to the women to go and whether to grow potatoes or corn or something that's going to give them some disposable income so that they look after the orphans.
In China, the picture you see up there now, there are major issues in China. You think of China as the world's fastest growing nation, and it is incredible, and they've done incredible things for issues of poverty. If you look at the world, you know, Millennium Development Goals, they'd be nothing if you took out China from that. But there's still, you know, when you're talking a fifth of the world's population, there are pockets, and so we're working in their pockets. Things like this village that sits here on the side of a mountain in Sichuan province, you know. We went there just following the earthquake back in 2008, thinking how could we help, realised the government's doing a wonderful rebuilding program, but these people are still poor and impoverished. So we looked at them and said, how can we help you address your poverty? And they said, well, we know that we could grow walnuts, but we can't get started. And so we turned that village, if you look at the next slide, it became quite different. If you move to the next picture, that's the village 9 months later, where it was all based on a new growing program. We brought in experts to help them out actually grow the program or grow the walnuts. We made mistakes. We got too ambitious and grew them too high, and half of them died, and all this sort of stuff, all the little learnings we take on. But, you know, we still made enough for the village to be able to increase the total income. And the whole thing of, you know, that when the tide comes in, all the boats rise, really is the philosophy that we covered. Mm-hmm. If you look at the next picture, we moved through to, you know, there's Ronnie's pig, actually. Ronnie, that's one of your big
only
girls.
Only one Ronnie.
It's going back a few years. That's little Tyler there. Anyway, move on to the next picture. We won't go into pig reproductive cycles. This is a girl named Dawa, who is one of the girls that fits into the point A category. So she at a young age of four was sold to another family because her family, one, was impoverished, and two, didn't have really any respect for girls. So she was sold to work as a house girl, a house servant for another family when she was found by her partner. And she had missed most of her schooling, and she was at the age of nine. Was she nine when she came in? So our job was to get her back into school and try and address the issue of education, because education is what's going to secure her future. And she, it's a huge story, but we have, you know, hundreds of girls that are being helped in that situation. And if you look at the next slide, we'll move through very quickly on this part. That's the orphaned Kenyan kids from AIDS that Julie was talking about. And then finally, the last slide is in Nepal, which is where we're spending a lot of time now.
So what causes you the most pain?
I'd like to look at a highlight, and then I'm going to look at the pain side of it. One of the amazing girl stories that we have in the next slide is this young lady that was part of this what we call the Sen Girls Home, and these are all girls that have come from nomadic backgrounds. So the standard, think about Abraham in the tent and Sarah, that's their background. And so they didn't have the opportunity to go to school, and very difficult to get there. Plus there has been a cultural thing for girls, they're Tibetan girls. Things are changing quite a lot, but back then, and even now, still in the quite remote areas, we're trying to give placing value on women is a really important part of what I believe in, and what I believe God calls us to do is to look after girls and women and give them a chance. And so anyway, I happened to meet a young man who was involved with this and the family, and they had come alongside and were looking after 40 girls. And so one of the girls that I happened to meet on the next slide, she was so sick. So next slide, thanks. There's a young lady right in the middle with the purple, the pink top. Her name was Dampshu, and she was sick every time I would go there, and I do that twice a year. And she, not that that sounds like a lot, but for her, she had TB, so very, very sick. And yet every time I went there, they loved to dance. Their exercise is dance, so that's all they did. And she just danced. So she would get up for me and dance. So I had a very special, you know, connection with her. And for us, it was like getting her medicine, because if we didn't help her, she was going to die. And out there is no medical facilities, there's no hospitals, you get expired medicines. So going to a proper hospital was a good 10 hours drive away on very bumpy roads. Used to love the trip there, but boy, oh boy. And very high altitude, so quite a very difficult, sparse area. Next slide. And as you can see, she's now free from TB. She has gone to a Beijing dance school. Next slide. Oh, that's another one of Tyler, and she's actually behind in one of the little Tibetan classes that we put pop Tyler in for a time. And now this is Damchu, and she's been given a chance that she would never have had a chance. And the reason she was originally at the girls' home was because both her father and her mother, her father and grandfather had been murdered for money. Her mother had gone into had real issues with mental issues after that, as you can imagine. And so they felt very strongly that she needed to be in a safe place, in a safe environment, because of the dangers of being a young girl in that environment. But for her now, she's now got this opportunity to dance and become a dance teacher and make a change for the next generation.
I love the fact that what you do is not cookie cutter. It's not like you go in and say, we've discovered that this works and so we're going to do that everywhere. Mm. You really go in, and I love that you're working with local partners. It's not like you're saying, oh, we're from the South Pacific, we know what you need up right. here. You're going right. in there and working with them, and I think that's really valuable and it's clearly really impacting and making a difference, isn't it? Mm.
I think that the pain side of things is seeing them when you first see these girls, and you know that they have not had the opportunities that we have. Like, our kids just get to go to school. It's just part of life, right? But for them, they get up really early in the morning, you know, 3 or 4 o'clock, and they're milking yaks, churning butter by hand so that they can have yak butter and to have flour and putting, yak dung out and dry, because that's what they use as fuel. That's what they use for the fire. So, you know, it's a totally different concept. And that is really important. That is still required. But bringing the education side in is really important for them to make choices and wise choices for the future.
I think for me, the thing I find most difficult is you can never do enough. Mm. You know, so, and the consequences of not acting is significant. It's, you know, it's life. So for every girl that we help in these pictures or in the various programs, there's hundreds others that exist that will remain unhelped and they'll miss out. So that weighs heavy. You have to learn to live with that, and it's incredibly difficult when you, especially when you sit there and think, I should be doing more. So, you know, burnout in our industry is an incredibly challenging point. A little bit like pastoral work of any kind, I think, to be honest, but the reality is you can never ever do enough, but you have to come to the realization that, well, this isn't my plan, this is God's plan. I'm doing my part. So the focus is, at least, Lord, help me do my part as well as I can. There are others that need to step up, and I guess that's one of the reasons why we like talking like this, because I believe right out here there's people here that God is impressing on them the fact that, you know what, it's time to do something different, whatever that happens to be. And I resisted that for years, and I regret that now. But
we're going to look at a little video now about one of the challenges that the girls face in Nepal, and one of the challenges that you meet, and an area that we're wanting to partner with you in, and that's trafficking, human trafficking, and particularly often what that leads to is sex slavery for a lot of these girls. It's not something we like talking about or even thinking about, but the reality is that it's happening all the time. So we'll have a look at the video and then we'll carry on from there.
Okay.
Not very long from now, you will see no Nepali women in Nepal. About 18,000 to 20,000 of Nepali women get stolen, taken across to India and sold into brothels every year.
माइती पक्ष पहिली पक्ष जस्तो आउँछ त्यसलाई बिहारेपछि दिन्छौँ. some of the more remote parts of Nepal. There are villages where there are no girls left between the age of 11 and 20. They've all been trafficked.
It's just a Kurama just about Ami Nepali or Rugori song to what you can't go the Haribani Amiru, Ambrodi Banu, Rambro Kana, Rambro Lano, Golai Lubin, you know. The still Bokona is to there is to guess of the there is an Amber Nevalma.
Para Rumaji, Majora, and this country. People are so far got the Nika and
once they get over the
border, there's very little you can do to bring them back.
अनि जान्छ तिम्रो घर जाउला भनेर भनिराख्ने थियो हैन मैले भने फुच्चीलाई लगेर जान्छु म एकचोटि गएर वहाँ औषधि गर्छु अस्पतालमा ठीक हुन्छ वहाँ भनेर भने वहाँ गएपछि तिम्रो आउन भनेर हामीलाई अनि आउन नदिने तर मलाई त ठिकै लाग्यो हैन आफू त आइहाले भागेर आफू आएकोमा मलाई यति खुसी भएन के फुच्ची नआएको हुनाले मलाई त्यति केही लागेन त्यो तर कसैले कसैको केही मतलब नगर्ने के कुरो सुन्ने पनि नै केही मतलब नगर्ने त्यही भएर अनि मैले सोचेँ कसैको हुन्न म अब मैले लास्टमा म जानसम्म पुगिसकेको थिएँ फुच्चीको लागि
Wow, too, isn't it? You guys have been working in Nepal for about 2 years now, haven't you? And I know that one of the partners that you work with is Helen Eager, mm-hmm. who's Delmay Ryan's mum, and you will have heard Helen's voice there. Mm-hmm. And some people here will know Helen. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us, can you help us understand how trafficking happens and why it actually happens? Like, we don't see it happening here in New Zealand. Why is it different in Nepal? Why does it happen there?
Why in Nepal? I think it's just the extreme poverty. When I go there, I was only just talking to Stephen last night about Kathmandu, and you go into the city and you're shaking your head at there's not much infrastructure. You know, people are trying, but the roads are bad, the buildings are bad, that it's very, very hard to get to places. So they're really quite behind in regards to that. And there's just so many people that just don't have disposable income. So no jobs. They are living in villages quite remote. And particularly after the earthquake, the Nepal earthquake, just decimated so many different villages around the area. And even now there are still villages where you cannot get access to.
So how does that poverty impact trafficking?
Right. So if you can imagine that you are a girl that is just in a village, you know, if you just think of a farm or something nearby, but where there's not much, where your house is just some, maybe a tarpaulin that goes like so, there's nothing on the ground, there's and you're in minus 30 degrees, snow. So survival is really, really hard. So if somebody then comes up to you...
Someone intentionally comes up to you
and says to you, I've got a great job that I think you'd really like. And just like the movie just said, we could, you know, have a look at Bollywood. I've got a job for you at a restaurant or a beauty parlour or at, like, even a... office job.
And I guess they can send money home to help support the family.
Absolutely. They're going, you know, you'll be able to send them back to your mum and your dad and your siblings. So all of a sudden these dreams that they've never even contemplated to dream. Oh. So
like,
it is plain and simple. They're tricked into it. they're guaranteed. Sometimes the parents know what's going on, other times they don't. There's relatives that get involved. And it, for me, when I first found out about it, it was just evil. That's the only word I can think of, that people would come up to come up to your, if you have a daughter or a sister, and coming up to them and saying, I've got a better job for you, I'm going to take you, you know, away to a really great place. And it can even be just a phone call. And they groom and they talk to the girls and then they want to get married.
How old are these girls?
Anywhere between, generally around the 12 to 22, mm-hmm. but they can be as low as 8.
And what are you actually doing with partners there, mm-hmm. and why is it working? Why is it making a difference?
Right, you can add to it as well.
So the key thing that we are doing there is it becomes, if you've ever been to Nepal, in India, it's an open border, so there's no security control. Effectively, we're like becoming the last line of defence, if you want to call it that, like border security. Even though some of our stations are not on the borders, they're inland, where there's major trafficking areas, believe it. The key point is that there are teams that are trained to look at what looks unusual. So it could be anything from a girl walking with a guy, or a young girl with even an older woman, or something that just looks unusual. They'll go up pretty much every 10 minutes. Someone at a border station that we, you know, one of the 10 stations that we do, will walk up and just ask a few simple questions, mm-hmm. of a girl and the person with, saying, you know, where are you going? What are you after? And if they answer those questions okay, then they're free to proceed. If there's some trigger of risk or concern, then they are the full force of the law to pull them aside and have a formal interview with them. And out of that process, they will find, obviously, in a lot of cases, it's still okay. Mm. But in some cases, there's just not enough knowledge about, be the girl who doesn't know where she's going, her family doesn't know she's going. They make phone calls and they can't corroborate any story. All these signs start ratcheting up the issue of, you know, there's risk factors here that are beyond control. And they eventually get to the point saying, we believe you're in the process of being trafficked. And the girl is just stunned by this. Many times they're mad at this because you're going to block my chance of a great job. So there's lots of anger and animosity going on. But for many, it starts dawning on them, you know, that guy who was dating me, he's my trafficker. And life becomes quite different at that point. So that's the process of what we're doing. It's the last line of defense. Then, of course, sitting behind of that. So everyone talks about the trafficking part because, you know, sadly, it's a great story that gets everyone's interest. Sitting behind all of that is this huge infrastructure of support, because obviously our concern is, well, this girl is being trafficked because she's impoverished. She's sitting there saying, if I stay back in my village, I'm going to starve to death. So what choice do I have? And I think this is a good deal. That's what they're going for. So we're going to say, well, boy, if we're going to stop her trafficking, what now? And so some will go through some sort of rehab if they've been trafficked and been rescued. Mm-hmm. Others are just returned home to families and their families are educated about trafficking. And still others, a new program that we're just starting this year called My Business, My Freedom, is all about microfinance to help them build their issues of income so that we can take migration off the table.
So you're doing not only the border stations, but you've got education programs that are right across the country too, hey?
Yeah, education's critical. We fund a radio that 3AN started a few years back, and we fully fund that program. It's going now to 92% of Nepal. Something like 24 million people are hearing that broadcast if they tune in. And it's a regular broadcast, but, you know, every 30 minutes there's key messages coming out about, you know, trafficking, latest tactics being used, or interviews by women being trafficked to try and address this issue of education. And there's school education programs going on. And that's all fine, and it's important. But until you address poverty, what do you do? You know, we don't understand poverty. We can't pray to God for food when our pantries are full, you know? It just has no basis. But when you're impoverished and you're desperate, you know, what are you going to do?
Any option sounds good then.
Yeah. Well, one of the pictures of the lady that you just saw on the next slide, her name is Mina, and she was one of the ones that had been tricked into marrying somebody, and then he took her across into India. And the positive thing that's come out of this for her in particular was the fact that she is now one of the staff at the border monitoring station. So she will interview girls, so she knows exactly what's happened, and she can actually talk about it from her personal experience. And her daughter, which you found out, had been blinded by the traffickers, she is now in blind school. So, you know, meeting, you know, young kids and just playing and just being a normal kid and growing up, you know, with love and support around her.
Do you see that happen a bit, where you, the girls who have been trafficked then end up working in the and helping
there's
supporting?
There's quite a lot.
They're the most passionate ones, right? Because they know what they've been through and they want to stop others.
So ideally what we want to do and what you guys, this actual border crossing project that we're looking at is about stopping it before that gets to, before they get... What happens if they are trafficked? Just give us the realistic but family-friendly version.
We can't be too realistic. you're going to have to use your imagination here a little bit. But the best way that I had explained to me by Rajendra, who was the man who started this program, wonderful, incredible Nepalese man, who himself is up in high levels now of government, actually educating officials on the issues of trafficking. He's just an incredible...
And he was actually a sponsored child of Asian Aid.
Yeah.
And there's a number of sponsored children that are now running this organisation.
The best way he explained to me, and this is what keeps his motivation going, because this is horrible business, but, you know, do it long enough, it starts to become even numbing to yourself, right? And you just carry on. Every morning he reminds himself that if he misses a girl at a border station, within 3 to 4 hours, she will go through the most unimaginable thing that all of you as adults can imagine. And she will service 30 or 40 men.
A day.
Within 3 or 4 hours. So this is the imagery that he wakes up with everyone saying, you know, this is a life, this is a child of God that we need to do something with. So that's helped me.
Makes it very real, doesn't it?
And it's after, I guess, hearing your guys' story. Andrew was here last year and he met with our staff team. We have a life group every Thursday and had an opportunity to chat to him, hear his story. And that's where, I guess, we were really impacted and challenged by hearing your story. We've since shared this dream, this vision with our leadership team here at Papsda. And this is why we wanted to get them here to hear the story and share it with you as a church. We've decided as a church community that we want to fund a border control post in Nepal to add and assist the work that you guys are doing over there.
That is awesome.
And that is going to cost, which hearing the stories and the impact this make is, who cares about cost? But that is going to cost $20,000 a year for 3 years for us to be able to fund and support the work you're doing there, which is the rescuing at the border, but then also the work that goes in that you've just shared with trying to build that education base, trying to alleviate the poverty and address the huge challenges that they face over there. Yeah. So after hearing and after sitting hearing the stories now this morning, even more I'm impacted with this sense we can't not do it. And so we just really, and this is church, us sharing with you, this is what we are purposing to do over the next 3 years is for $20,000 a year, support the work of Captivating and everything they're doing in Nepal.
Thank you.
I was just going to say that a lady who's very involved with anti-human trafficking around the world, and she told a story and it's resonated with me and has just stayed right at the front of my mind, is when she visited some women who had been trafficked from the Ukraine into Greece. So this is happening all around the world, so it's not just Nepal. We've heard stories in Australia, which is something that you just can't fathom. But she met with these women and she said, you know, we're here to help. We're coming alongside you as sisters. And this woman just looked at her in the eye and said, why did it take you so long? So for me, if we always have that at the front of our mind, you know, the Lord is asking us to get involved in whatever way that is, and whether it's involved in this or something that he places on your heart, you know, that's a part of our relationship with Jesus, is to meet those needs.
Absolutely. You guys have really committed your life to this. You left a high-flying corporate life to do something very, very different. is charity work for everyone? Is this kind of work for everyone?
Oh, heavens no. So I think maybe is charity work for everyone? No. Is mission for everyone? Yes. Mm-hmm. There is a difference, I think. I remember hearing a sermon preached once by a guy named John Piper, and he was talking about mission, and he said, as Christians, if you read your Bible, there's three decisions you can make about mission. And he said, one is you go, two is you send or you equip others to go, or three, you disobey. And I thought that was a pretty interesting position on mission, because when you think about charity, if we broaden the word charity about the very clear command that's given to us in the Bible about loving people and serving mankind and caring for the poor. You know, think of so many stories that come out of the Bible about what Jesus witnessed, you know, evidence to the world about his compassion, his empathy. The reality is all of us are expected to model that. So do you need to go to China to do charity? No, you got it right here. The charity is everywhere around you. It'll be the chance to be charitable. And Jesus talks about the fact that we're to help the poor. And he talks about the poor in spirit. You know, you don't have to be financially poor to meet the criteria of impoverished. Jesus is concerned about our spiritual poverty. And all of us face that. Everyone in this room, at some point, you have a responsibility to hold up your fellow man and help them who are poor in spirit. You live in a beautiful place of New Zealand. I wish I lived here with you, to be honest. But I love Australia. But the reality is we are surrounded by people who are impoverished spiritually. And Jesus is making a clear call to us, get engaged and do something because you are my hands and feet in doing that. Some of us choose to do something radical and go out to China, and we rely on people to support us in that. Otherwise, we have no job to do. But we are no more important part than the person who equips us. We all, you know, we're all part of the body that's to work together to achieve these things. We get actually all the fun bits because we get to look into the eyes, we get our hearts broken, but we get that thing to say, you know what, I feel I'm part of God's plan. There's plenty of times, you know, I could talk a long time on this, there's plenty of times that we have sat there and questioned, what are we doing? Was it a mistake? You know, should I just be back in Australia working the corporate job and that sort of stuff? But then something will happen that makes it very clear that, you know what, this is part of the plan. In fact, you know, when you contacted me about perhaps to get involved, having to talk to you about this story, that very same weekend is when 3AN approached us saying, we're in financial challenges without the rest of our human trafficking program, Captivating, can you take it all on? You know, that's beyond us. We're thinking, we can't do that. And so they're thinking of the hundreds of girls that are not going to be saved that month if we don't continue on the program. That very same weekend, you responded saying, you know, Papsda we'd like to fund a station. Another group responded about another station. And so we, with confidence, were able to go back to Regenera and say, you know, let's do it. Let's push hard through this. And we will, you know, your program alone will intercept 100 girls a month.
Wow.
100 girls a month. And in our view, although we'll never know, that action is saving their lives. You know, for us, that's as serious as it gets in the world of charity.
Mm-hmm. I'm just doing the calculations. So that's potentially over 1,000 girls a year. So that's $20 can rescue a girl. $20 can make, the world a difference for a girl in Nepal.
Yeah, think what you would do as a parent if your child is going to be trafficked. What would you do? You would mortgage the house. You'd do everything. This is someone else's girl that they can't. They're powerless to do anything about. $20.
Now, obviously, when you enter this kind of work and environment, your view of God, people, humanity is impacted. How's that change shifted for you over the last few years?
I think for me, it's seeing people in a different light. It's that we're all the same. Doesn't matter where we live or who we come in contact with. For me, God has shown me that there's a God in heaven who loves us, and who loves people who are desperate. So we are all part of that humanity, right? None of us are better off than one another. We are all equal. But in some areas of this world, they're not so equal.
We could have been born in Nepal or China.
Yeah.
And I think that's, for me, what has been that responsibility that comes alongside of that. And there's a heaviness that comes with it. And as Andrew said, it can be quite, challenging. But you know, we have a saying, one girl at a time. Mm. So that for me is quite that's my connections.
For me, my spiritual growth, I always joke that Julie's faith in I'm works, but that my spiritual growth has taken a gone through this, through that whole period. Some people think you're doing charity work, so you're on the spiritual high all the time. No, it's sometimes it's flushed down the toilet. But the bottom line is that there's things that happen that shake you to the core that previously in my controlled world of corporate life, I can't control. And so you just got to trust, and you think, I don't like to trust. You know, I pray to God, and I'm in my head, I'm working out the strategy about how we're going to do it. You know, it's like, come on, what's the fraud? And we had a series of problems. You know, every year something happens that is devastating to us. You know, either the death of a girl or whatever. And you sit there and you throw up all these questions, why? And the very first time it happened, this is where I look at my faith barometer through the 10 years. And back there, confident Andrew, who controlled his domain, when a bad thing happened, my faith dived because there was no God. And I was angry. And I was saying, you're supposed to love these kids more than I do, and yet this one's died. You know, how did you let that happen? So the faith goes down the toilet, and you flush it and you kick it out. But then you pull it back and you realize at that point, you know what, I have to pray to God. And that's the point. You start praying, you realize, why would God listen to me? Because I've never really prayed before. I'll get my composure in about 2 seconds. It happens all the time. All right, I'm back. So, and you realize that this is the issue, I think, of living a comfortable life. You know, we buy insurance because, you know what, we can, and we don't need God. And, you know, it's all sorts of different stuff. Made me realize how simple a life that I had as a practicing Christian. This is my story. I can't talk about anyone's story here. Last year, we lost a girl that was the most precious to us. She drowned. 2 seconds. And the answer to that, when I prayed to God, was, I don't know why you didn't help, but one day I'm going to find out, and it's going to be amazing.
And I love that picture that the Bible paints. We don't always understand it. We don't always get it. But God has promised that He will restore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He will restore all things. And we hold on to that and we look forward to that.
Mm. Yeah. Mm.
If we can, to close, in 1 minute, if you had 1 minute to say to everyone here and to us what it is you think we need to understand and know and hear about this whole reality, what would you say?
Do what Julie says and everything will be fine. Be my 1 minute.
That's the humour coming out. For me, it's God wants us to be authentic, loving, kind, compassionate, generous, and He will pave a way for you to get involved in whatever that is for you personally. And you'll get an aha moment that this is for me. And for my story, that was in James 1:27, which was religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless. It's to look after widows and orphans in distress and to speak up for those that cannot speak. So I guess that's my story, and that God loves you. God has a plan for you, and you just watch. You know, you pray, enlarge my tent, and you will see what He will do.
My 1 minute would be, and I speak mainly to all the guys out there who are...
You can even stand up, Andrew.
No, I won't stand up because my 1 minute is, time is on your side. Okay, so don't forget the fact that this life represents this much of your eternal existence. In fact, we can't even measure the length of that. You got time. Don't ever sit there thinking, getting anxious because you're not working hard enough or not building a bigger house or accumulating stuff. This is what I used to do all the time. You don't need to do that because you've got as much as you want in eternity. If you are genuine about your faith with Jesus and your trust with him, this is really just about two things. And it's about making the right decision and getting Jesus in your heart as the Lord and Savior of your life. And then trying to work out how to drag as many people with you as possible. Because you know what? You got all of this eternity. I don't know, most of you in this room, we could spend 1,000,000 years together chatting away in heaven and it's still a nothing in time. Don't get too obsessed with this world. Focus on the things that what Jesus, focus on those things that will bring eternal value, because that's what Jesus wants of all of us. Time is on your side. Don't panic about you. It's actually not about you.
That'd be my I love money. That. Let's not grow our kingdom. Let's be about God's kingdom.
Love your mission, love your heart, and we have been really blessed to have you here today. Every time I talk to you guys, I am so inspired, and it's been over the last few years now, and not only by your story, but by the stories that you tell. In church, you know, I'm so impacted by different stories, and by actually putting a little girl's face there to behind these stories and thinking, wow, that could have been my daughter. That could have been me. Mm. You've passed it on.
Sorry, my bad.
No, don't be sorry. I think it's so easy for us here in New Zealand to sit there and think, oh, my life's a bit hard. You know, I wish it had gone this way. I wish I wasn't sick. I wish my kids had done this. I wish I could afford this. I wish I could go on that holiday. But when you actually bring it down to the fact that actually last week I went and I ate out. Last week I probably ate out twice. And in reality, $20 is going to save one girl from a living hell. And that might be a movie ticket, that might be half a new t-shirt, it might be some petrol, some, you know, it's just not that much money in our lives, in our scheme of things, compared to saving one girl from that hell. And that's what we really need to be thinking about, isn't it, church?
And so today we really want to, I guess, challenge each and every one here. You might have noticed there's a little card on the seat, and in the seat pocket in front of you, you might find a pen if you don't have a pen with you. We just want you to consider, how can you make a difference? How can you make an impact? And we know we can't change everything. We know we can't make a difference for everyone, but you can make a difference for someone. And so we just want you to have a look through. Leanne is going to talk us through this pledge card. But as we live out God's kingdom here in South Auckland, you know we have purpose, and there's a lot of things we're doing to make an impact locally. We also go out and serve in New Zealand and the islands, but how can we make an impact in a very real way in Nepal? Leanne, talk us through this card.
Okay, so there's 20,000 girls that will be trafficked in Nepal this year, and Andrew and Julie are going to be working with teams to intercept 3,000 of those and about 1,000 at the station that we're going to sponsor here as a church. $20 can make that difference for a girl. Now, if you want to be a part of this team, in whatever way, shape or form, we'd love you to write your name there at the top. And as Norm said, there are a few pens in some of those, the Bible holders. One thing that we can all do is that we can pray. These guys need our prayers. Yeah, Rajendra, who's one of the guys in Nepal who's leading the team there, his daughter was threatened and actually taken, wasn't she, as a threat to them to try and... The traffickers actually got their daughter. They rescued her. But these guys live in real life and death threats every day. And we can pray for them. We can pray for these girls. So you can put a tick in that box. One way we thought we could make this really real is that you can support the rescue of a certain number of girls. So you might say, I want to support one girl, and that would be a total of $20, and I'm going to make that a one-off donation, or I want to support four girls, and that's $80. I'm going to make that a one-off donation, or I want to make that monthly and ongoing for the next 3 years while this project's going. So you might want to think about that as a family, or how can I make a difference in an ongoing way? And then we'd like you to either fill in here whether you're going to go out to Guest Central and do you take the form out there and do the FPOS machine and so on out there, or if you'd like someone to give you a call in the week and follow up with how you can best do that. And then Andrew and Julie have some amazing monthly updates that come out. And if you'd like to be a part of that and to get those monthly updates, I get them every month and I'm always inspired and I'm always in tears. So write your email address down there and then you can be in touch with them. You are better to make your donation through Papsda rather than directly to them. If you do it through Papsda, it's a tax deductible donation for you, which means you get a third of it back. But I also want to say that here at Papsda, as a church family, we have so many opportunities to be involved in really good things. And this is one amazing, incredible thing. But we have lots of good things. And we recognise that everybody can't give lavishly to everything. So just think about how God's impressing you. Think about what is wise and what is responsible for you and your family and your financial circumstances. And how is God calling you to make a difference for that one girl, or maybe more?
We're going to give you some time to do that now. I'm going to invite Jay to come forward. And he's just going to sing a song that I guess highlights or speaks to the heart of this matter. So while you're considering maybe chatting to the person next to you about it, we'll hear from Jay.
Thank you, Jane. And thank you, Andrew and Julie. We now get to be a part of your team, and we get to vicariously do this through you while we sit here in our comfy pews and you're out there at the coalface. And I guess as a church family, we just want to say thank you for being willing to follow God's promptings in your life. Thank you for being willing to take really big risks that must have seemed really scary and must on a day-to-day basis seem scary. Thank you. Thank you for being really raw with us. Tyler, thank you for sharing your mum and dad with us and for a lot of other people as well. And we are just really grateful that we get this opportunity to serve alongside you guys, and thank you for being willing to do that with us.
Thank you.
Let's give them another hand, guys.
So we're going to pray now, but we'd love for you to stand and join us. And we've got a thing that we do here at church. Just we invite the whole church congregation to show a show their support by raising their hands to the front. And Tyler, do you want to join us up here? Can we actually put you, let's stand down here and then we'll lay our hands on you and pray for your family, your ministry, and the whole Captivating team. And Leanne, I'll ask you to start and then I'll finish.
Father, we are incredibly grateful for the stories that we've heard today, for the way that we have seen your leading. And Lord, today I just pray for your continued leading in the lives of Andrew and Julie and Tyler. Father, I pray that your angels will protect them. I pray that you will continue to inspire their minds with new and innovative ideas. I pray that you will give them the energy that they need and the passion that they need every day renewed from you. Lord, we pray for the partners that are working overseas, and we pray for the girls that will potentially be intercepted. And we pray for those girls that have not been, but that will yet be rescued. And Lord, we know that you hate this brokenness and this sin in this world, but we know that you've got a way better plan. And we thank you that we have that light at the end of the tunnel. And we thank you for that we get to be a tiny little part in this process.
Lord, we are so grateful that you have called us and that we can be a part of restoring and reconciling in this world. Lord, we thank you for Captivating. We thank you for their their mission. We thank you for the awesome work that they're doing, and we pray a blessing over their ministry. We pray a blessing over their efforts. We just want to lift up this family, and Lord, give them strength, give them energy, give them whatever it is they need, peace, give them endurance. And Lord, may we as a church family hold their hands up high so that they can continue rescuing and being the difference for these girls. So Lord, we thank you again for the awesome opportunity to partner with you and to partner with Captivating. And we thank you that we have this awesome opportunity to bring freedom. That's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Thank you, church, for being here today. Thank you for your patience. I know we have run a little over time. We did forget to collect the offering. So today, all of our money goes to Captivating. You can go straight out to the FPOS machine. They're ready for you. Or deacons, if you could stand by the doors, that would be fantastic. And we'd love you to just give your gift. Whatever you give today is going to go towards our $20,000 for Captivating this year. If you want to talk to Andrew and Julie, they're going to be out by Guest Central right now. And you can catch up with them and ask them any questions. Have a great week.
Thank you.
Thank you, Norman. Thank you. That was just so lovely. You guys did such a great job.
That was awesome.